Imagine you're a fossil. You were lucky enough to die in a place that was conducive to making fossils. Then you were buried and managed to persevere for thousands or millions of years without being broken or crumbled or washed away. After all of that, you get discovered by a researcher and you're set for a life of luxury in a museum where you'll be cared for in a perfectly controlled environment. And then you get lost in the mail. Unfortunately, it's not an uncommon story. Every so often, disaster strikes and precious artifacts from the ancient past are lost for a whole range of reasons. But that doesn't mean we can't still learn from them. So here are five of the most important fossils that have gone missing over the years, plus one that made it safely back home. In 1927, archaeologists discovered a hominin tooth in Zhoukoujian, an area about 40 kilometers outside of Beijing. 2 years later, they discovered a skull cap at the same site. Its sloped forehead and prominent brow ridge told researchers it was from the species Homo erectus, one of our evolutionary cousins. Excavations of the site continued until 1937, turning up fossils from at least 40 different individuals, all dating to between 770,000 and 230,000 years ago. This particular brand of Homo erectus came to be known as Peking Man for the city that we now call Beijing. The fossils were studied at Peking Union Medical College, but as you may know, that wasn't the safest place to be in the late 30s and early 40s. Japan had captured the city in 1937, and by 1941, they were getting ready to get the US involved in the war in the Pacific. In an attempt to save the precious Peking Man fossils from being damaged in the war, they were smuggled out of China and sent to the US. Or at least, they were supposed to be. See, they, never arrived. There's been plenty of speculation over the decades about where they went, whether it was a train heist or just a bureaucratic mistake. Whatever happened, the end result was the same. An entire decade's worth of precious hominin fossils vanished. Luckily, the research team had made plaster casts of the fossils, so we do actually know what these missing fossils looked like. But with new research methods like isotope analysis, there's plenty that we can't know without the real fossils. Although, this may not be the end of the story. In 2010, we got a new clue thanks to the son of a US Marine who had been stationed in China in 1947. He said his father told him that when the Marines had been digging foxholes one night, they dug up a box of bones. They were, understandably, freaked out, so they just filled in the hole and dug another one. But naturally, anthropologists thought that this shipping crate full of bones could be the missing fossils. So anthropologists went to the site of the military base that the guy had been stationed at to poke around. But when they got there, they discovered that it had been turned into a parking lot. Since suspicion of fossils isn't good enough grounds to demolish an entire parking lot, the recovery mission pretty much stopped there. However, local officials have promised that if the area is ever redeveloped, they'll keep their eye out for any boxes containing ancient hominins. Our next missing fossil was also buried, but not by humans. In 1989, a dig in Alberta, Canada, unearthed the cast of a single footprint that appeared to belong to a juvenile tyrannosaurid. The footprint shows that this dino's toe was bent underneath the foot, and evidence of injuries like that can be hard to find in the fossil record, which made this a pretty special paw print. Unfortunately, when researchers returned the next year to try to excavate it, they couldn't find it. Turns out that the area had experienced a rock slide, and the unique track was now buried under layers of rubble. So scientists have to be content with photos that were taken of the track, at least until it's re-revealed in a couple million years. Easy come, easy go. This next fossil loss stings a little more than some others, not just because of what went missing, but also where it came from. Some locations just don't lend themselves to skeletal fossils, like the Connecticut River Valley of the American Northeast, which is why it was exciting when a complete dinosaur skeleton was discovered near Mount Holyoke College in Massachusetts. This dinosaur was just a little guy, about 18 centimeters long. It was also bipedal and carnivorous. The fossils were embedded in a boulder, which is where the chair of Mount Holyoke's geology department, Mignon Talbot, spotted it while out for a walk way back in 1910. She named her new fossil Podocosaurus holyokensis. Professor Talbot was the first woman to find and name a new dinosaur species, making this fossil important for paleontology and for feminism. Talbot was big on curatorial work and helped Mount Holyoke acquire a massive collection of specimens, casts, and fossils that rivaled the collections at bigger schools like Harvard and Yale. But then, in 1917, mean, disaster struck. The building that housed the collection, Williston Hall, burned down due to an electrical fire. So all of that history was just gone, including the Podocosaurus holeogensis fossil. Even worse, to date, there have been no other confirmed fossils of the species found either, so it's really gone. But all is not lost. Researchers at Mount Holyoke have started an initiative called the Podocosaurus Project to bring more attention to this miniature dinosaur. They're going through all the surviving records and archival materials to re-examine them and see what we can learn. They're even planning on publishing a new description and analysis of what branch of the dinosaur family tree it falls in, shedding new light on some old bones. And in 2021, Podocosaurus got some extra love when it was named the State Dinosaur of Massachusetts. Not bad for a skeleton lost to time. Twice. Which brings us to our next missing fossil, but before we dig into that, a quick ad. This SciShow video is supported by ACT. Maybe you know ACT as the makers of the number one taken college admissions test in nearly half of US states based on 2024 grad class data. But they're not resting on those laurels. Enhancements are coming to the ACT to streamline the student testing experience. The enhanced ACT boasts the shortest test time yet with more time per question. That way you have less time pressure and more time to go back and review your answers or work through the harder questions. These enhancements reflect the ACT's commitment to student feedback. After all, you're the one taking the test. You can learn more about the ACT and decide if it's right for you by scanning the QR code or clicking the link in the description. While it's great that Podocosaurus got her flowers in the end, other lost fossils are controversial enough that they probably won't be named a state fossil anytime soon. Take Spinosaurus aegypticus, for example. In 1912, a German fossil collector, with support from a German paleontologist and the Bavarian Academy of Sciences, discovered a partial dinosaur skeleton in western Egypt. They found some crocodile-like teeth, a lower jaw, and vertebrae with large spines on them. These spines would have stuck upwards in a sail shape, which could have been used for maintaining temperature, to help it swim, or as a display. Or maybe it wasn't a sail at all, and it was really just a hump that stored fat or something. Spinosaurus was the largest carnivorous dinosaur ever discovered, with a body as long as 18 meters. For comparison, our friend Tyrannosaurus rex was about 14 meters long. A couple of decades later, a second batch of Spinosaur fossils were discovered in the same location. They had some similarities with the first specimen, but were different enough that they couldn't say for sure whether the bones belonged to Spinosaurus aegypticus or a new species. The fossils were shipped back to the Paleontological Museum in Munich, where both specimens resided until the night of April 24th, 1944. In the middle of World War II. The building where those fossils were kept got hit during a bombing raid by the British Royal Air Force, and most of the fossil collection from Egypt was destroyed. Fortunately, the researchers' notes and drawings survived, but those can only capture so much. It's especially frustrating because several more fossils in its genus have been discovered since 1944, fueling some pretty intense debates about the different species. And the fighting doesn't stop with species distinctions. Paleontologists also argue over where these guys lived, specifically whether they were aquatic or semi-aquatic predatory dinosaurs. If they were, they'd be the first, so it's pretty important to get that one right. As more specimens have come to light, scientists have confirmed the predatory part. Spinosaurus ate fish and had a whole bunch of adaptations that would have allowed them to live in water too. Their nostrils are oriented to keep water out while swimming, and their bones were pretty buoyant. Plus, with their long necks and short hind legs, walking on land might have been difficult, leading some to speculate that swimming was their preferred mode of transportation. Other researchers don't deny that these adaptations are present, but they say there are other things that could explain these traits besides an aquatic lifestyle, and even some that say the water was a total no-go. Computer modeling studies indicate that given its body shape, a spinosaur in water would just keep tipping over and rolling onto its side, which isn't ideal for a predator. And their bones are actually so buoyant that they might not have been able to, like, submerge themselves to swim, which again, not ideal for an aquatic predator. So without those all-important missing fossils, we may never know whether this idea would sink or swim. To be fair, these kinds of paleontology fires don't actually need that much fuel to burn, because historically speaking, paleontologists are a fiery bunch. Case in point, The Bone Wars. In the late 1800s, the rival paleontologists O.C. Marsh and Edward Cope were fighting to prove themselves as the best fossil finders the world had ever seen. And when it came to trashing each other, they did not hold back. There were spies, there was bribery, there was publicly sullying each other's honor. They even tried to inflate their own stats, naming nearly every single fossil they found as a brand new species. It was a whole thing. And while the paleontologists involved came out of their feud broke and discredited, they still did find a lot of dinosaur fossils, including a massive sauropod, Amphicelius fragilimus. Maybe. In 1878, a paleontologist working for Edward Cope discovered a piece of a vertebra in Colorado. The arch of this particular vertebra was 1.5 meters tall, which is about the size of a pool cue. From that massive backbone, it's been estimated that the whole dino would have been 58 meters long and weighed more than 122,000 kilograms. That is a dinosaur almost as long as an ice hockey rink, and that's way bigger than any other dinosaur ever described. A dinosaur of that size would quite literally be groundbreaking. Around the turn of the 20th century, the vertebra was sent from Cope's private collection to the American Museum of Natural History in New York, where it was received, checked in, and assigned a catalog number. 2 decades later, the museum finally decided to go through the Cope's extensive donated collection and discovered that the Amphicelius fragilimus fossil just wasn't there. They had no idea where it had gone or what happened to it. It was just missing. So all scientists have to go on are the original notes and Cope's original description, which leaves room for lots of controversy and speculation. Some scholars even suspect that in the frenzy of the Bone Wars, Cope made a typo when writing down the size of the vertebra's arch. Instead of being 1.5 meters tall, they think it may have only been 1.05 meters, which would drastically reduce the body size estimate. Other scholars think that the measure could have been right, but the math used to extrapolate that to the size of a whole animal was wonky. However, it's now known that Cope's rivals had actual spies embedded on his research team, so if he'd flubbed his numbers, those spies would have ratted him out. Sadly, nobody's found any other fossils from this big boy that would confirm his size. And there's another problem. When other researchers looked at the drawings, they suggested that the bone may have come from a different taxon of dinosaur altogether, which would change the calculations for estimating the size of the animal from its vertebra. And if it is from this other dino group, the math says this dinosaur would be 30 to 32 meters long, which is still big, just not record-breaking. But without the fossil, we'll never really know. It's a mystery, and a big one at that. Fortunately, sometimes missing fossils do come back, which brings us to our final titan of the fossil world, and a story nearly 200 years in the making. In 1828, dinosaur fossils were discovered in India. These were the first dinosaur fossils ever found in India, and dated back to about 70 million years ago, back before India had joined up with Asia, bringing species from other parts of the globe with it. At this point in history, it was actually down near Africa. The fossils were passed around for a while before they were described in 1877 and recognized as a new genus and species of dinosaur, Titanosaurus indicus. But after that, they just disappeared. Nobody really knew where they had gone or what happened to them. And they weren't alone because a ton of Indian fossils have just gone missing over the years. Which is a bummer since figuring out what species were around in India and when they got there could tell us a lot about how species spread. So India's fossil history is a pretty tantalizing mystery to unpack. Which is why the Geological Survey of India and University of Michigan teamed up to see if they could find some of the missing fossils amidst the storeroom chaos. And that's a lot harder than you might think. See, most fossils aren't like complete pieces. They're bits and pieces of leg bones and ribs. And unless you're an expert in exactly that group of creatures, you might not really know what you're looking for in the jumble. Which is why carefully numbering and cataloging your fossils is super important, so anyone can tell what they are and who they belong to. But for some reason, T. indicus never got its number, so it had to be recognized by sight. Curators had searched around where it was supposed to be, looking for a match, several times, with no luck. luck. But this time, the team used a much more systematic approach and managed to track down those Titanosaurus indicus fossils. And it turns out, it might not be as giant of discovery as we'd hoped. Titanosaurus indicus has now been labeled a dubious genus because we can't really tell if it's a unique category. There just aren't enough specimens to know. Imagine being a fossil reappearing after decades hidden away, only for scientists to be like, "Actually, you're not special." I don't know about you, but I'd simply go back into hiding and become yet another fossil on the never recovered list.